Thank you, good evening. Thanks very much for coming. On my way here, I passed London Fashion Week, and I guess this is sort of a London non-fashion week, any event about the EU, very much things not in vogue. It's going to be purely questions, no speeches from here, and then at the end some questions hopefully from you guys. I just wanted to kick off so we can place people a little on the spectrum of perhaps FT readers to Daily Mail readers, or FT readers to Spectator subscribers. But whether I can ask the panellists in turn to say whether in 20 years' time you think the EU will be around in its current form, and will the euro be around in its current form. And I just actually before I, while I give you 30 seconds to think about that, I've been specifically asked that people should be precise. So this event's the future of Europe. And Theresa May, I'm sure, would remind us all that Europe is still going to exist, and Britain's still going to be part of it. So the continent is one thing, and obviously we want to distinguish that from the EU being a very different political structure. So could I start with you, John, and ask, do you think the EU and the euro will be around in their current form in 20 years' time?
Well, I'm just a lawyer anyway, but I did venture some predictions in the course of our discussions earlier in the afternoon. I went out to 85 years ahead, and got severely caned for it. So 20 years, maybe I should be willing to talk about 20 years ahead. I personally expect that the European Union will be around in good institutional shape in 20 years' time, and I wish it luck. I'm glad we're out of it, but
not yet.
By intention, an intention that I share. But here we are. And one of the good things about us getting out is that the very bad features of British foreign policy. Historic foreign policy include the intent to dilute Europe by extension to the east, and in particular to take in Turkey, but all that goes with Turkey, which extends as a national population for another 1,000 miles to the east. And there was no known limit to the Foreign Office's policy, pro-Arab policy of integrating all that. With Europe, and I think that was a disastrous project. There remain, assuming that we treat that as, assuming that the, so to speak, rump of the European Union, the 27 that survive after one that's gone, handle that problem and resist the various inducements to take Turkey in, which I think would be entirely fatal for the institution, even in the medium term. I don't see why they won't survive. Well, but there will be still big problems about the further east, inside the European, so to speak, landmass. But the problem of the states, including Bulgaria and then the states around the former states, a number of former states of the Soviet Union, will remain a constant problem. And unless that is solved sort of cleanly, the Union may fall apart. The possibility that the eastern states, which are socially conservative, and have on the one hand suffered under Soviet domination, but on the other hand have a kind of attraction, as I think they should have, and I think we should have, to various aspects of Russian cultural political policy, they will be torn between falling under a Russian domination that they don't want, but resisting a Western European corruption that they also don't want, and in joining with Russia and in resisting that. So who knows how that will work out? I certainly don't.
Larry, can I ask for your prediction? So that's we don't like it, but it's going to stay around. What do you think in 20 years' time?
Well, I said earlier that I myself would prefer a Habsburg, a rather messy Habsburg Europe to a disciplined Hohenzollern Europe. I think it will be around, and I think it will be probably a looser form of association than it is now, and there will be different degrees of membership, something I would welcome. And we're used to thinking of there being two spheres, the Eurozone and then an outer sphere of EU membership. I would quite like a third sphere of associate membership and with bridges between them so that countries, it would not be impossible for countries to move in and out of different spheres in this associated enterprise.
The euro, Pauline, your prediction for the euro and the EU in 20 years' time?
Well, it's always risky to make predictions, especially as a political commentator. You don't want to put yourself in a... Can you hear me now? You don't want to put yourself in a situation where they stop inviting you to panels because you made a wrong prediction. No, I think that the populist movement that we see now in Europe is so strong and has such momentum that I think it's inconceivable that we have the same kind of union and the same kind of euro in 20 years' time.
Noelle, do you share that?
Well, if you ask the ambassador of the US to the EU, he will say that you don't have to wait 20 years to see the European Union collapse and euro. My view is that in 20 years ahead, I'm a pro-European. I'm convinced that there is no other way. And in the short term, Great Britain will leave and Montenegro will be a new member, replacing the UK. So we'll be stabilized. And in 20 years I've never been there, but I think that can be very, very interesting to go. And I think that China will have the leadership of the world. So, and I think and hope that Mr. Trump won't be there either. And perhaps Mr. Putin also, even though we don't know with regard to Putin, because he will be there in 20 years ahead. So I think that the Union is not a nation state. It's very flexible. So there is no danger, in my view, for the euro. There is no danger for the EU. I think we'll have an army, a military, because we have no choice. And I hope that Russia, which is partially European, will change, will evolve, and that we'll have an international role. We won't be the leader of the world, but we'll have a very important role between the Western world and Asia. And we'll have a privileged position. So I hope that the Financial Times didn't exist to be against the euro as you were during the Greek crisis. Every day you had the euro but I think that you changed too, because it will be a great success.
Unfortunately, you won't know because you told me off stage that you cancelled your subscription. So
For another reason.
But sorry, just to go back to you, and I should say that Mr. Trump's ambassador to the EU has not been nominated, and I would take anything Ted Malik says with a pinch of salt. But does something give way? Does NATO give way if the EU continues to expand in that way that you talked about? It moves into an army.
No.
Does something to some part of the current infrastructure in Europe change?
No, I think that the Balkan states, they are irreversible candidate to the EU, but I don't think that Turkey will join because of reasons, different reasons, especially cultural. And I think that Europe will be a big actor on the international scene because of this mixed culture. But Europe is a specific entity. It's not comparable to any other political entity in the world, and I think that after Brexit, either it will collapse, which I don't think at all, either it will really take account of the necessity to be strong, but with nation states. I'm not communist, I'm not Marxist, but I don't think that there will be the collapse of the nation states and a society without classes. And I think Europe will be a stronger actor with China as a leader of the world.
And by Europe there, you mean the EU, too? Or
Europe.
You mean Europe,
EU,
the
EU.
EU, yeah.
With Great Britain as associate member.
Great. Andy, how optimistic are you?
Not on for that, are you?
Sorry, yeah.
Okay, so let me split the difference. On Europe, yes, it will be around in 20 years in some form. I agree with my colleague, all my colleagues on that, but one, I guess. It's the most successful voluntary form of international cooperation in world history for all its faults. It works surprisingly well for most of the problems that it tries to solve. An exception to this, however, is the euro. I wish I could say that the euro would not be around in 20 years, because it's a terrible policy, and strong polities, and I think the EU is a strong polity that's been around, after all, longer than most established democracies in the world today, strong polities get rid of policies that don't work. The European Union doesn't have the courage to do that, and politicians are very short-sighted about not wanting to accept the short-term costs of getting rid of it for the long-term gains that they would reap places like Italy. Result of that is, it's a close call. Nobody knows for sure, but I think probably they'll muddle through and it will still be around. So the final point, though, is the EU that's around, although it probably will look, or what we see now will still be part of it, has, for the last 25 years, been plateauing in a certain sense. That is, it's adopted some policies that are very ambitious, like the euro, which haven't worked so well, and other policies that are more intergovernmental or more flexible, it has more multi-speed qualities. And I think that suggests a kind of natural plateauing for the institution, no matter what the scenario is, because it's in a sense exhausted, or is beginning to exhaust the functional problems that it can reasonably solve, because that ultimately is the major justification for it. It's a extremely effective means of coping with interdependence and should be talked about and sold as such.
I mean, just to pick up on that, because that's actually not an uncontroversial statement to say that there is this plateauing in terms of integration and speeds, although, I mean, there are some suggestions for, double tracks or triple tracks. In fact, the reaction to the Brexit vote was that we needed more integration. The reaction to the Greek crisis from many quarters is you can't have this level of monetary union without a greater degree of fiscal union, willingness of Germany to help out poorer countries in southern Europe.
Right.
So do we think that the current rate of integration is likely to go quicker or needs to go quicker, or is likely to go slower amongst the states that remain?
No, I think it'll be something the same. I mean, on multi-speeds, I know every generation we discover the same thing and think it's new, but Europe has been moving in a more multi-speed direction, of which the British have been great beneficiaries for the last 25 years. Not everybody's in the euro, not everybody's in the social policy, not everybody's in Schengen in the same sense, not everybody participates in foreign policy operations, people have different arrangements for sharing information. I mean, this is extremely diverse body, largely due to, in many ways, the beneficial effects of Britain. So the irony is Britain pulls out exactly when it gets the European Union right where it wants it to be, right? But, and with new policies, yes, things come up, what we in America call homeland security cooperation or internal home affairs, but I think that is slow, and you're not going to see big mega projects like the euro anytime soon.
Larry, you mentioned the hope of a few spheres for the EU. What out there at the moment gives you confidence that that might be the future? Are there politicians championing that? Is there evidence for you?
I think there are some politicians, and I was yesterday and this morning at a meeting in Louvain, talking to a number of French MEPs, former MEPs, who are disturbed by Brexit, and we talked about this idea of associate membership. Perhaps France is uncomfortable with the idea of being left alone with Germany. I don't know. It seems to me the great tension in the EU at the moment is, apart from the fact that opinion has become what's, I suppose, usually described as populist in so many countries, and and the euro reaction to the euro in southern Europe is completely understandable. The process of integration has stalled, really. And one of the problems that's going to perhaps continue the stall is that since the enlargement to the east, the EU has taken on countries where social attitudes are very different from those in Western Europe. In that way, I think I said earlier, it seems to me Europe is much more like the United States in a way, in its cultural wars, and is likely to remain so for some time.
Do you agree with that, Noel?
Well, I don't think that integration is stalled. I think that the Treaty of Lisbon has given to the EU, you know, new field of competencies. And of course, with a weak governance, when you have a lot of competencies, it doesn't work well. But you have had, I think, about 47 new domains in which the EU decides at the majority voting, which is enormous. But I think that integration has worked, even though many countries suffered, because of the role of the ECB, which has been remarkable. It's really an independent bank, which has taken its independence, even towards the German, who didn't agree with its policy of quantitative easing. And there is a paper which has been published by the Council of Europe, or the European Council, sorry, on its website last Friday, showing that Europe, and the growth is not, you know, 10%, but that the economy of Europe is recovering, and that it is not awfully bad. The real problem in certain countries is that there is bad governance, and that, of course, we have this issue of the gap between the rich and the poor, which exists in our democracies in a way which has not existed as of the last century, I think. Not the last century, but the 19th century, you have really this problem. And also you have populism, but as I said before, thanks to Mr. Trump, we don't think that there is a relationship between populism and Europe, because Europe is not the United States. So there are other reasons. The only thing which is true is that populism is rising everywhere in Europe, Eastern Europe, Western Europe, even the UK, where when you look at what was said during the campaign for the Brexit or Remain, it's amazing to see this country, which for us, continental Europeans, is a model, because especially of the last world war and the tradition of democracy, but what has been said during this campaign. And also, these buses to ask for people to denounce illegal immigrants, for us, it's not Britain. I'm sorry to say that. I can say that because I have the same criticism against France with regard to the situation of France today. But for instance, paradoxically in France, you have, if we had a referendum on the EU, 60% of the people will say no, I think, or 55%. But a great majority of the people wants to keep the euro. And that is why Mrs. Le Pen, she deleted the chapter in her program asking for to leave the eurozone.
Now, can I... is that the case?
She doesn't ask for it anymore. Yeah. She says that. Right. Yeah. I'm not a friend, but I've
heard that. I got that far.
The best is true.
Paulina, what do you think has gone wrong with the way that integration's been pursued? Has it been pursued in the wrong manner, or have the wrong things been given emphasis?
Well, it depends on which country you look at. And I can give you an example from Germany, for instance. After the EU enlargement, when Romania and Bulgaria became members, Germany had enormous problems with people pouring in to live as beggars in Germany on the streets. Same thing in Sweden. There isn't one small town in Sweden where you don't have a Roma beggar from either Romania or Bulgaria. We even have shanty towns in Sweden. You can go to the outskirts of Stockholm and you have real shanty towns where these Roma beggars live. And so socially we're in a situation that we haven't been in since the 30s, with beggars everywhere, people sleeping in the streets of Stockholm. Is it the same in France?
Absolutely.
Yes.
And this is one reason of the rise of populism.
Sure, and then you might have elites who tell you that, but we're all Europeans, and this is our responsibility as well. And it sounds real good, but people don't believe in it. They simply don't believe that they have a social responsibility for the poor, poor citizens of nations far away.
Is that the fundamental tension at the heart of the EU project, is the lack of an identity on which to base it, a lack of a share?
That is one central problem, yes, and it's manifested in this way.
And in Sweden you don't see that changing, you don't see people over time accepting that we receive benefits from the EU and therefore we also maybe pick up costs in terms of paying for those who withhold bonus.
No, they see that we're paying a very high price. We see it everywhere, on every street in Stockholm. And that this is something that hasn't got to do with us. Sure, we want to help, we want to pay, but these are not our poor. So that's the conception that we have.
John, do you see that as a question of whether the question is raised whether the EU is there just to give us benefits or whether it's there that are almost tangential for us, or whether it's there to promote an identity which is assumed to be a good thing. Do you see that tension continuing?
Well, there's a question about what its aims were or are, then there's a question about what's happening, as it were, independently of the aims. If you've got rich welfare states and no border around them, then the rest of the world will arrive, and it's in the process of arriving. And so the fundamental problem, which makes me not wholly confident about my position, that in 20 years' time the show will still be on the road, is that it has no institutional capacity at all to protect its external borders. When I say at all, that's an exaggeration, because in the last year, steel fences have been put up by various states of the Union, as well as other neighbouring states, but that was done against the very strong dynamism of the EU bureaucracy and of the opinion of EU elites throughout Europe. But however many steel fences you put up and man, so to put it, with vigorous guards, you've got the entire soft underbelly of the maritime coast of Italy, Greece, Spain, which is undefended and essentially under European law, indefensible. And the European law has been installed both by the legislative organs of the EU, but it's been locked into place, as it were, in a way that can't be broken except by radical constitutional change, by the courts, both of the European Court of Human Rights and now equally enthusiastically, of the EU itself, the Court of Justice of the EU, which hold that it's simply contrary to every basic principle of human rights and of the EU to engage in maritime interdiction of flows of people across the Mediterranean, and that the Australian policy is simply pushing them back so that they don't even try to come, they know they're going to fail, is strictly unlawful, and is in fact wicked, according to the ideology of the EU. So I think that since that's an unsustainable state of affairs, rich welfare states, several billion people who have very good reason to want to share in them, some of them share as productive contributors to them, and others to to share in them otherwise, you've got an unsustainable situation, and the EU has contrived, as I say, to lock itself into this position, which in the end I think is unsustainable.
And there is a question, sort of welcome to the Valentine's Day lighting, which is something that we've got tonight. There is a question about whether that desire to protect human rights by the courts for in the question of migration actually makes it harder to protect human rights on the domestic level, and whether it creates a cultural conflict which both the courts and politicians struggle.
That's another dimension of it, that it's not just people who are coming into the welfare state, but that there are people with a rich, potent culture of their own. Many aspects of which, in many cases of these peoples, are antithetical or opposed to substantial parts of European political culture. As the European Court of Human Rights has solemnly held on two occasions, Sharia law, as a dogma of that faith, is simply incompatible with EU principles, and they've specified a number of them, and anyone can specify another two or three incompatibilities. So, since they will, other things being equal, make up the overwhelming majority of the incomers whom we are preventing ourselves from preventing coming in, we are creating a further structural problem.
So this is the idea that the EU has become so rigid, the type of integration that's being pursued is sort of beyond the control even of particular politicians.
This was unnecessary, because those who actually crafted the European Convention and who crafted the Refugee Convention, there was a strong overlap between the set of countries that did both, and they were done at the same time. Both sets of founding fathers, so to speak, were perfectly clear that they were not recognising a human right to enter as a refugee. The Refugee Convention does not grant a right to enter. It says if the state has taken a refugee in, then the refugee has such and such rights, including a limited set of rights not to be expelled, but they're limited. The European Convention was designed to say nothing whatsoever about asylum or immigration or entry of any kind. So the vast structure of asylum law and right to remain on the grounds of private life, family life, etc., has been created substantially by the judiciary under a doctrine of living instrument interpretation, so-called interpretation, all misinterpretation of the intentions of the public intentions of the founders, but with the enthusiastic applause of the media, the academic, and the legislative institutions of the union. Now that applause is becoming somewhat faint as the realities of the consequences are sinking in, and so the initial extreme hostility to Orban's fence policy has withered away, and he's now joined by a number of member states promoting that. But these other aspects, which I keep emphasising, that have been created by the court, but the approval of directives, remain in place, and it's very, very hard to see how, short of a crisis of constitutional character, that can be overcome. Now, then the word populism comes in, and I would say we should reject the term populism outright as a simple left-wing insult to those voters who have adopted policies contrary to the left wing. There is nothing populist about Trump. He's not appealing to some sort of notion that the people, as opposed to the Constitution or such like, have got rights. He's not a fascist or a Nazi. He's not suggesting any kind of change in our institutional structures. He has a set of policies about immigration, the protection of the country against both excessive numbers of economic migrants and cultural threats, including terrorism. and a number of other policies, some of which are simply conservative Republican policies, which were successful in the last election. There's nothing populist about
it. What I would say is that the problem with arguing that populism is just an insult by left-wing is that there are left-wing populists, like Theresa and like whatever. And so, I mean,
But can we take the same set of facts and give, a more pragmatic and balanced account? Because I don't think we learn a lot by pigeonholing people with labels like this. So let's just, whether or not we think it's a good thing or a bad thing or a right thing or a left thing to restrict immigration, let's face facts. It's going to be restricted. All right? So it's going to be restricted. It's been restricted in the United States under Obama quite considerably, so even though one might think that Trump is something new, it's not. There is no political coalition in any one of the 28 countries that's going to permit to happen again what happened in the summer of 2015 with external immigrants. And that's why the European Union is now pursuing a policy not of redistributing immigrants by quotas, which was always something that only applied to less than 10% of the migrants anyway. Yeah. So it's really a red herring that Orban very cleverly had a referendum on a policy that, to a first approximation, did not exist. Right? Instead, what the EU is now doing is systematically finding ways to close the borders. So yes, you build fences, you sign deals with countries to take people back, you make Europe itself a less pleasant place to be, and the result of that is that from the summer of 2015 to now, you've seen a decline, or actually to the summer of 2016, you saw a tenfold decline in the number of migrants coming in from any source into Europe. Right? Even across the Mediterranean, which doesn't have a fence, right? Countries can do this. It's a distasteful thing. We don't feel good about it ethically, but it is the only sustainable political compromise. Now, if that's what European countries want to do, the European Union is A, already part of doing it, and B, it's essential, because you need to coordinate the activities of countries, the military ones, the legal ones, and so on, in order to do this effectively. And so I think focusing on, this or that judicial decision or this or that feelings of people in Brussels on this issue is completely irrelevant politically. What matters in the European Union is what all the member states want to do. And what they want to do is restrict immigration, and they will, come what may.
They do.
So I think we need to think about the EU as a kind of pragmatic network, not this kind of idealistic thing where people in Brussels hold sway over us all, because that just isn't the real world.
There was not a tenfold decline. There were 180,000 immigrants into Italy alone across the sea. So it can't have been tenfold decline, because there weren't 2 million coming in the previous year, only about 1 million.
Yes, but I think, of course, I fully agree with the observation that as built on the social model, the social state model, Europe is fragile and is attractive, as are the US as well, of course, even if it's not based on a social model. But you see, I think that this issue has to do with something else. I agree that we restrict immigration, either based on the agreement, which is not very glorious, if I may say, so with Erdogan, you have to remind that you have 1 million refugees in Lebanon, 1 million in Jordan, and 2.5 or 3 million in Turkey. And in Europe, except in Germany, you don't have, and Sweden, which is number one in welcoming migrants, you have not so many new migrants. First thing, and it shows the limits of the limits that the states keep the main responsibility of the politics they lead in Europe. It's not a top down completely, because you have harmonized texts on the asylum rights, for instance, but who is responsible to look at who deserves to be to come into the country? The states, the administration of the states. And for instance, in Germany, it seems to work rather well, because Germany has welcomed about 1 million refugees, and they have selected very quickly, in 3 weeks or 4 weeks, as I've been told, they know who is to be recognized as a refugee or not, and then they expel those who do not deserve. And in France, it takes, you know, 1 year, and during 1 year, you have the refugee and you cannot. So you see, the problem with Europe, which is accused of so many things, is that the member states agree to compromise and to make decisions so to facilitate, you know, their cooperation. And then it is up to the police, to the judiciary, to the custom agents, officials, to do the job. And it's not, and you talk about Italy, but do you think that without Europe or Greece, we will, as French or even British, but Britain is an island, as was said by your professor of sociology, Britain is an island with water all around. It began its lesson like that. So it's a bit perhaps different here, but we wouldn't have left Italy without our help anyway.
The Italian government policy was to push back migrants to Libya, and it was implementing that policy vigorously until it was stopped. It was stopped by the EU and stopped by the court, EU court.
You know the situation in Libya, well, and what would be very efficient is to fight against smugglers. And
that's what they do. Can I bring in Paulina here and ask? I mean, one of your fears, as I understand it, is that women's rights within Europe, so the freedoms and the opportunities that women have taken for granted are now under threat, and that the EU has become, instead of an empowerer of women, but has become a threat to them. Is that how you...
Well, not the EU, perhaps, but when you have events like the mass harassment of women in Cologne on New Year's Eve 2015, when you have an event like that, you trigger the anti-establishment movement. I'm not going to say populist, you're absolutely right. So they trigger the same anti-establishment movement that then turns against the EU. So the migration issue and the European issue are linked in that way as well.
You had perhaps the most negative interpretation of where the EU would be. Do you see women being the strongest voice in trying to change the status quo? I mean, at the moment, I guess we have Marine Le Pen, who is an example of that.
I think eventually women can become a much stronger force when it comes to being anti-immigration. Yes, they're not right now. Usually it's more common that men are against large-scale immigration than women, but I think that might change.
Okay, we're going to move on to questions in a second, so please have a quick think. But just before we do that, I wondered whether we could touch upon the EU and its future, and Europe's future, and the security threats to it. I think, Noelle, you were the one who touched on it very strongly, saying we don't know whether Russia is going to be a cooperative power in...
But Russia was always... and always the deal that Russia is a weak economy, but Putin is a strong politician. And I must say, because we are very few here, that interferes in French politics. And this is true, and interferes in US politics.
But can we think
so? And this is a new paradigm. It is a tradition, because the Soviet Union, you know, for instance, the Communist Party in France, which represented 35% of the votes after the war, because of Stalin, there were resistance. You had the resistance in the UK with the gold, and you had the interior, so-called interior resistance. But you know, they have always interfered, the Soviet Union has always interfered with internal policy, then of Western Europe. Then with Gorbachev, it changed. Because Gorbachev was a Western-oriented person, and he is hated in Russia, as you know. And now again, Russia interferes in national politics against Europe, and Russia wants the collapse of Europe. But what is new is that after having intervened in eastern countries of the Soviet bloc, again, Russia intervenes militarily in Georgia, in Crimea. Kaliningrad, former Königsberg, you know, it's a sort of couloir corridor in Poland. It begins to be a place where you don't have only mafia in the sense of in the civilized sense of the word, you also have interference. So I think that the main challenge is not there is no consensus in Western Europe, especially in my country, with regard to the relationship with Russia. And clearly, for instance, Mr. Fillon is pro-Russian, and it has been, you know, part of the definition of the programs of the party, much more so than Europe. And I think that in this regard, it is perhaps with the migration or integration of cultures different from ours, from the Judeo-Christian culture, this is a big, big challenge. And I think that in this regard, I don't see a clear solution in the short term.
Larry or John, do you have a strong view on whether that Putin Russia, Putin's Russia is going to be around, or whether that has to be the way in which the Europe defines itself in terms of thinking ahead?
Well, I frankly think we've rather bungled our relations with Russia, underestimating their sensitivity to things around their borders. I mean, we shouldn't forget that they lost 25 million people in the course of the Second War and effectively won the land war. Sparing Western countries a great many dead. I think at times we've been a bit naughty in doing things which, well, let's take the case of Ukraine, suggesting that it might soon become a member of the European Union. I mean, there were promises dangled, I think, or suggestions that, you know, this might soon be possible. And
they won't, but they...
Well, I agree, they won't. But that isn't the point. The point is, I think, you know, the coup in, if you want to call it a coup, some people don't want to call it that, in Kiev, was certainly aroused partly by encouragements that, you know, closer relations with Europe, being part of Europe, would mean that the Ukraine could separate itself from Russia in a way that Russia finds intolerable, actually, given that the eastern Ukraine is largely Russian, I think.
I strongly agree with that. I think our the EU, American policy, British policy as well, as British as much as any, in relation to Russia over the last 7 or 8 years has been a catastrophic mistake. If there is Russian intervention, I think unproved in either American or Western European politics, it should be presumptively explained as sheer self-defense against a highly aggressive EU-American anti-Russian policy manifested with great clarity in the second debate between Hillary Clinton and Trump, when she spat out the word Russia with deep hostility. But it's structural. So the sort of provocation in Georgia, which is sort of American provocation, the provocation in the Ukraine, which is largely EU but with a lot of American backing, has led to a Russian self-defensive foreign policy, which has some military aspects, but the general sort of background thesis, which is sold to our populations by these elites, that Russia is a military threat to Western Europe, is, in my view, laughably a false premise for Western policy.
Great. And so we can think about whether Europe's allies in the future will still be the US, or whether they may even be elite. Great. It will be.
Serious.
Sorry?
Be serious. It's just not a viable decision.
Okay, we'll touch that, but I'm sure people have questions on that matter. Can we turn to questions? I don't know whether we need a microphone. I mean, you're fairly close, so I think you're probably all right.
Yes, it's just a microphone problem.
If you could say a brief word about for your problem, how you voted in the referendum. Just a short question would be great.
My name is Richard Galba. I'm working in a law firm. I voted to leave. I would have voted to leave at Maastricht. So I'm anti-Europe, anti-EU, but not anti the EU of mainland Europe. I think that's a very good system. My question is, and it's been touched on but never really addressed, EU's got a lot of problems, but one of the unaddressed problems seems to be demographics. The birth rate of Europe is below replacement. And it's got an aging population and a very well-defined welfare system. How is that going to continue in the near future? And I think you have addressed it in a way with immigration. Is it going to be immigration from Africa and Asia and South America? Or is there another system that anybody has thought about?
Great.
I never hear it being mentioned.
Who would like to take that? Does anyone have a thought on how Europe handles its demographic challenges? I can tell you that.
It's a big issue. I think that Mrs. Merkel has part of your answer. Because obviously, in welcoming refugees, it has to do with the needs of the level place to get new. And for instance, when you go in other countries, you have very learned and qualified doctors in the rural areas because no one wants to go there. So in France we have about two per, especially in the Maghreb families. So demography is a big issue for Europe. That's true, but it's difficult to oblige women to make children, and if you want, you can adopt 10 children, like you can do that. Do you?
But where do the children come from? That's the question.
But you have to choose. You go to Russia, there is a lot of orphanage, and you can have 10 very nice.
Andrew or John?
You cannot ask women to have 10 children and to die at the age of 40 because you had at the time of women had children older. You had many women dying at birth.
Andy, did you want to jump in on this? Or,
I'm not an expert on this.
Okay.
I started off this afternoon talking about this as one aspect of the general structural decay of Europe, which is part of the sort of background to the political, institutional, legal framework. So it is decaying. The native population, so to call them, are simply not sustaining themselves or anywhere near it, and will decline by of the order of a third each generation until. And here's where I made my 85-year prediction on the basis of Thilo Sarrazin's, when he was a member of the Deutsche Bank governor's book, Germany is abolishing itself or fading out, or however you translate the German or the French title, in which, by a series of very careful, sophisticated, cautious analyses of the last 40 years of demographic and related issues, he shows that in 85 years' time, it's probable, but he's more cautious than I was in saying what's probable. So it's just the model gives you, well, 20% of Germany will consist of 80% people of non-German origin and 20% of people of German origin. Now, you know, on a sort of abstract human rights, etc. perspective, what's the problem? Or if you say constitutional patriotism is the only patriotism that is respectable to think about, what's the problem? There's no problem. It won't work out like that. These populations are not going to live together, and when you've got, in the case of Germany, the Prime Minister of the country from which most of them come, flying in from time to time, holding mass rallies,
to say, you remain Turks, don't become Germans, don't become infidels, remain Turks and Muslims, you are just setting a course for catastrophe. And since it's indecent to talk about having children as a national policy, except in some rogue countries like Hungary, and since we've set up carefully on partly human rights grounds, equality grounds, a social system in which it is highly expensive to have children, so that it's a natural reaction to have, you know, the 1.3 per woman that is German, Italy, Spain, and so on, huge reductions in the population in each generation. It's of course not difficult to have children. I've got quite a few myself. But it's expensive. And we've set up a system of in which the idea of a family wage is discredited as an anti-woman idea. So we've locked ourselves in again, in this respect as well as in the ones that I mentioned before.
Great.
That does set me off. I think this is the kind of scary rhetoric that really doesn't serve us very well as public policy analysts or as citizens. I review the books on Europe for Foreign Affairs Magazine, which is the big, establishment. Foreign Affairs Magazine in the United States, and I get, dozens of books every year on how Europe is going to be speaking Arabic in 15, 20, 30, 50, 80 years. Each one crankier than the other. I read them all and see if I should review them. And, there are now 2.4% of Germans are Muslims. They have more kids, so they're responsible for 9.1% of the births in Germany, which means that 91% of the people born are German. If you extrapolate any trends out over 90 years, you can get all kinds of things. So imagine yourself sitting there in 1930, 85 years ago, and extrapolating forward to what you think the world is going to be like now, right? It's not very useful, and it's particularly not useful in demographics, where we know things like, poor people have a lot of kids, but as they get richer, they have fewer. People assimilate to greater or lesser extent in various societies. So the idea that we should really be making public policy on migration today on the basis of the notion that Germany might be two-thirds non-white in what would it be, the year 2100, when none of us are going to be there, is, I think, just not good public policy.
And I think it's fundamental to good public policy.
Yeah. Let's take can we take a question from the man in the
thank you. Tom?
Yeah.
I'm actually a local councillor with one of the Berkshire unitaries. But the thing I feel as though I'm let down, I suspect a lot of the younger people here feel the same way, is the lack of truth in the Fourth Estate, that truth hasn't been presented properly. Both sides seem to cut away with telling lies and lots of misinformation. That it's a very complex situation. How do we actually get briefed properly in terms of what the true story is and what the facts are? Because there just seems to be so many contradictions. I suspect quite a lot of the students here would agree with me on that.
Yeah.
Listen to professors, we all agree.
Did I mention I'm from the Financial Times? my thought on that would be this. Europe is not an issue that the British press covers particularly well. And one of the sort of slightly paradoxical things is that we have a lot of newspapers who think we're run from Brussels, but they don't actually base any correspondence in Brussels, which means that their understanding of it can be somewhat limited. We're also, as a newspaper industry, in structural decline. So that puts certain pressures on the type of freedom you have to talk about things. But I want to say that this is a problem that people in the journalistic world are aware of. And I think if you've looked at the developments over the past 12 months, you've seen fact-checking websites. The you've seen a surge in fake news, but also quite a quick reaction in fake news from people like Facebook. I mean, the chances are that, I mean, I think initially the stance was they wouldn't do very much, but in the, they very quickly realised they have to. So I think, you know, it's something worth reflecting that things don't only have to get worse in that regard. Does anyone have any stones to throw at me other than the journalistic profession?
No, but even the BBC has lost its, you know, people lost respect for the BBC, and that should be the ultimate in terms of dispassionate impartial.
Well, I think, I mean, one of the, I'm not sure, I mean, the trust figures on BBC are pretty high, I think sort of 80s. And what, one of the problems is if you have a divisive referendum like you did in Scotland and like you did in the whole of the UK or over the EU, people who feel passionately on both sides will just hate any messenger that they don't agree with entirely. So I agree, you know, a respect for nuance would be quite helpful.
Yeah, there's good news and bad news here, right? The good news is I think the system can adapt in this way. So, for example, in the United States in the last few months, it's a very different situation than it was during the election. During the election, journalists did not say, this is an incorrect fact, or this is just not true. Right, when somebody said something that was just not true. And now they do. So that you get more immediate fact-checking and then flagging and calling out of people that fact-check. There's a big difference between debate like the one we just had, where we're working with the same facts, we just disagree on some assumptions about what is a reasonable way to analyze it and what might happen in the future. And people just making stuff up. And getting rid of the people who make stuff up, I think, is feasible and useful. The bad news is this, that people probably won't listen. So speaking as a professional political scientist, one of the things that, you know, every undergraduate learns is that the construct in the mind of your average voter is not one that's heavily fact-based or let alone fact-checking. It's based on a set of kind of prior beliefs that then lead them to interpret incoming information in a certain way. And so what, and there's a very deep lesson here which is troubling for us in these times, when effusions of unstructured, purportedly democratic behavior like the internet and referenda and so on start to dominate how we organize politics. And that is that politics in a world where people don't have the time or inclination or capacity sometimes to process information in a sophisticated way are held together by belief systems and habits. You know, you were a labor voter for a long time, and you just kind of bought all that stuff, and whether it was right or wrong or indifferent, you knew you were kind of broadly on the right side of the political spectrum for what you believed, right? You approximated in that way. Once you get the breakdown of major parties and all these new sources of information flying around, it's very hard to structure a polity that way. And so you get a lot more surprises. And so on.
Andy, can I interrupt you? Just bring in Pauline. I mean, if you're concerned around the sort of the sexual threats to women as evidence in Cologne, I think we had an example yesterday where the press regulator here said that actually some of the reporting had just invented similar incidents. I mean, is there a risk that actually, say, women's fears about immigration just are based on scare stories rather than facts?
Well, this was a story from Frankfurt, the one you mentioned. there was a rumor in the Deutsche Bildzeitung saying that there were was a case of mass harassment on New Year's Eve in Frankfurt. And it turned out to be entirely false. And the thing is, here, social media help. If there are outright lies in the media, then people can fact check really fast and get out on social media and show that the media, the BBC or whoever it was, published something that wasn't true. So this is actually a positive thing.
Great. Any more? Sorry, were you sorry? Were I interrupting?
Well, but that was that one story in Frankfurt. The other stories from last New Year's were all true, unfortunately.
Yeah. Should we try and take a couple more questions if we can? Gentleman in the front row.
Thank you. So you opened up, my name's Henry Newman, and I'm from a think tank called Open Europe. You opened up by asking the panel to make some predictions about the future of the EU and specifically the Euro as well over the next 20 years. I'd be interested to hear predictions from the panel about Britain's place in over the next 20 years. Do they see Britain making a success of Brexit? do they see, and what sort of, I'm sure there'll be different views across the panel, and what sort of relations, structural and otherwise, will Britain have with the rest of the EU on matters beyond trade, security, intelligence, defence, and so on?
Noelle, can I start with you on that one?
Well, I'm not British. I think that the main issue, as you know, is where will be the hub for American finance? Will it be in Dublin or in Frankfurt? Paris, I don't think, but I would wish. This is the main issue, because it is true that the UK, even though you wanted to leave, but the UK has this privileged situation between the leader of the Western world, the United States, whereby, you know, all happens, and then 10 years later, the Europeans do the same thing. So it was a privileged situation. And in addition, the UK in Europe had also a privileged situation with all the opt-outs. So my view is that even though I'm convinced, and more convinced when I see what Trump is doing, that politics rules the world and not really economics. Otherwise, Mrs. Merkel would love Mr. Putin, and she is the only one in Germany to try and to stop the desire of all the business to go in the arms of Putin, because she is a politician. So I think that, and it is really obvious when you see Mrs. May hand in hand with Mr. Trump, that the UK need also to find an identity in the global world, because the UK is traditionally an international country, which is a bit paradoxical to leave the EU being an international country. But it's really in its tradition. I think that it has a role to play. But when it won't be any longer the hub, and the city will not be the same, what will happen? Now in the EU, for instance, there will be no longer British as an official language. It will be Gaelic instead. So I think that you have to prepare this. You say we'll have trade agreements. The trade agreement is not enough to have an international role. And another issue, which is very important, is the future of the UN, of the system of the UN, because it's obsolete. I'm not Trump vis-à-vis Europe, but I think when the community which represents the world is made of two-thirds of dictatorships, it would not work, really. So we have the Security Council. I think that you have to think about the city, your international role, between the West and the East and Asia, and also the issue of the UN and the role of Britain.
Can I bring Larry in, where Britain will be with relation to the EU?
Well, I think, paradoxically, there's an increased chance that what will emerge is a federal Britain.
A federal?
Federal Britain.
And so not an independent Scotland in the EU. What kind of relationship will this federal Britain have with Europe and with Brussels?
That I don't know.
So let me talk about the Americans, because look, America is key. So if you're Brexiteers, you're hoping that America is going to come in and save you all. But let me tell you, it's not going to happen like that. I mean, Mr. Trump in 3 weeks has already fundamentally changed his campaign promises on Russia, China, Israel, and NATO, just for starters, right? This guy cannot deliver, okay? He can't deliver because some of his policies aren't based on facts, but the serious thing is that, we have a very strong set of foreign policy interests in the United States, and it's very hard to sustain a fundamental change in those. So Trump will probably start negotiating some kind of trade agreement with Britain, but the universal, and I mean universal bipartisan sort of technical view about this in the United States is you can't do that until the Britons sort out their business with Europe. So that's 2, 3, 4 years down the line, because you don't just need to get out, you need to get some agreement in place before you do that. Trade agreements customarily, despite what you read in the British press, which amazes me because it's pretty easy to fact check, don't take 30 months to negotiate. The one that always gets cited, I think, with Colombia or one of those countries, took 198 months actually till full implementation. And so these are extremely difficult things to do. And the general view in the United States is the British position is actually pretty conservative. What they want to change in their relationship to Europe substantively is not nearly as great as the rhetoric would lead you to believe. You know, keep the single market in place, you know, all that kind of thing. So, so the hopeful scenario is that Britain renegotiates in a way that satisfies people formally and deals with the immigration problem, which may deal with itself within Europe, and not that much changes except the name. But either way, you know, the United States is not involved until that sorts itself out.
Great. Just I'm going to quickly take a couple more at the back.
Hi, I'm Francesca, second year law student here. I just had a question about, we were making predictions at the start. In terms of the European Convention of Human Rights, in the next, I guess, 20 plus years, do you see it having a less significant role or a greater role within Europe?
Brilliant. And can you pass the Convention of Human Rights? Yes, could you pass it back to the gentleman there?
Hi, my name is Brent McGill, and just extremely interested. When we talk about threat of migration, we usually think of waves of either low-wage or unemployed migrants. But what about highly skilled and educated labor flows? Because I can assume that the poorest who are not ours are willing to come from the poorest periphery of the union, so is an educated doctor or engineer. So what, in the context of the future of Europe in 20 years, what does sort of an internal brain drain in the union look like, and how can that affect Europe?
Great. Who would like to kick off on some of that?
Well, I'd like to kick off partly to answer, you know, give an answer to the question that was raised over here, but it links with all of them. I think the likely outcome is that it'll be a pretty hard Brexit, that the attempt to negotiate some sort of quasi-participation in the common market will break down, partly for the reasons that Professor Moravchik says. Negotiations of trade agreements are very difficult. You don't actually have to have a trade agreement. Most countries do not have a trade agreement either with us or with the EU, or indeed with the United States. There are severe disadvantages in not having a trade agreement, but they are just severe disadvantages, and they are manageable. They are highly tolerable disadvantages if either you just have to put up with them, or you're willing to put up with them because the penalties of joining a trade agreement would be more than you want to pay. And they can be of various kinds. So I think it's likely that we'll come out in 2 years' time without a general trade agreement, but that there will be all kinds of specific agreements, that, such as, for example, in relation to universities, a kind of continuation on another basis of Erasmus, simply negotiated at the level of universities. I think in relation to sharing security, we will negotiate a special security sharing, data sharing policy, which is not specifically EU. It'll be us and the EU.
Have 2 minutes? So can I just ask you on? I know the ECHR point is probably.
Yeah, well, I think Mrs. May had the most unsustainable, indefensible policy of all going into the referendum, namely that we should stay in the EU but get out of the ECHR. Mm-hmm. She was right about the latter, we should get out of that, and she was wrong about staying in the EU, we should get out of the EU, we should get out of both, because both are highly unsatisfactory international courts, which are of overweening arrogance and are corrupting our own judiciary. In a certain sort of sense of corrupting, enticing them into a living instrument modality of constitutional interpretation.
Do you think it will be less influential, the ECHR?
The chances that we will get out are less than 50-50. I think we should, and I hope that once we've got out of the EU, she will return to her first love and try to get out of there.
No, could I come to...
Well, I know the British issue with regard to the Human Rights Convention. I think it's a very useful convention because the Council of Europe, as you know, gathers Western countries and countries of the EU, and also, for instance, Russia and Turkey, which have become both the main clients of the court. And in that respect, even if it has not changed dramatically the attitude of Mr. Putin, which is worse, I'm sorry, I'm not against Putin as a Russian, but against the methods of Putin of intimidation that the EU and Erdogan, it's very useful to keep the link. But there is an issue which is not British, but which has to do with Europe, European court of human of the EU, which means that there is not only conflicts of power between politicians or between the UK and EU, etc. There are also conflicts of power between courts. And the Court of Justice of the EU has given two advices in 1996 and 2 years ago, saying we don't want the EU to ratify the Convention of Human Rights because we don't want to have the court in Strasbourg to be our boss. And they are trying to kill the court in Strasbourg. And as a lawyer, I think that the court in Strasbourg is rather prudent now, much more so than the ECJ. I won't comment because it will be too long. But I think it's important to have this model because one of the main factor of integration of European culture and political culture are the courts, the two courts. It's much more difficult for them because they are very much criticized, but they are not so much criticized by other member states. But I think that the main danger is perhaps the European Court of the EU because it is rather arrogant. And there are issues, especially the veil I'm not against the veil, but there are sometimes where in the companies they want to regulate the way the people have contact with the clients. And I think that vis-à-vis the member states, if the ECJ goes too far to deal with social, in a way, political issues, such as national identities, religion, etc., it will be terrible for Europe because the member states won't accept that, for instance, the tradition of secularism, which is so important in France, is not respected at EU level. So I fear the ECJ much more so than the court in Strasbourg, so the country of the British, but it is usual between France and the
UK. We can all look forward to the Daily Mail front page headline which says that the ECHR is being rather prudent now. great. Thank you very much to all the panellists for their predictions and their thoughts. Thank you very much for coming, and it would be nice to give a round of applause to these panellists.